Hey guys, Ramsey here. Welcome to another video. Today we have a ranked family portrait, and it's from one of the houses that I have a ton of bottles from. It's actually a house that I would say really influenced me diving into the fragrance game head first. And it's a house that I would say is extremely controversial because of their history, which seems a little bit made up, especially when you look at the facts that have been coming out and the books that have been written. Like, for example, if you're into fragrances, this is almost a must-read book. It's called The Ghost Perfumer, Creed, Lies, and the Scent of the Century by Gabe Oppenheim. And it is about Aventus, but it's also about the House of Creed and Olivier Creed and the history of Creed. And what's funny is, you know, he wrote this and he was never forced to retract a thing, okay? He had lawyers look everything over. He never got sued. He was never forced to recant a single thing he said. And he said things about a lot of people. There are things about Roja Dove in here. There are things about Olivier Creed and Pierre Bourdon and, you know, other perfumers. And the fact that he never had to say he was sorry or that something had to be amended goes to show that it was probably true. If you're a perfume fan, I would urge you to read this. The reason that I say controversial is because, you know, many of their fragrances are extremely overpriced, in my opinion. And when I first started this hobby, I made a mistake, okay? And the mistake was I equated price with quality. And in this game, you will learn very quickly that price and quality are not necessarily the same thing, okay? So you could have a $20 fragrance be absolutely stunning and amazing and high quality. You could have a $399 fragrance be absolute shite. See Zerzhov, you know. See these expensive fragrance houses that pop up out of nowhere that all of their stuff are $300. Or even this mid-tier line like, you know, Mancera's, for example. You think you're getting something good, but they're all synthetic trash to me. You know, that's the type of thing that I mean when I say price doesn't necessarily equal quality. So, let's get into this. We're going to do a top 25 Creed countdown, and we're going to have one honorable mention, okay? And so, before we get into this, though, I would like to do Scent of the Day, because it's customary to do Scent of the Day, so let's talk about my Scent of the Day. And today I woke up on the wrong side of the bed, and I was kind of pissed off, which I will wake up on the wrong side of the bed from time to time, and I will be pissed off at the world from time to time, and I needed something to really bring me back down and ground me, and this scent does it every single time. I've probably worn it 7 or 8 times since I've had this bottle, which is a lot of wears for me when you consider the collection. And I continue to reach for this. I love it. I'm going to do my This Is Not a Top 10 Chypre fragrances, and I'm going to rank this probably very close to the top, if not at the top. This is Roja's Diaghilev. And Diaghilev is, I mean, what isn't Diaghilev to me? It is, you know, it has this tarragon, zesty, citrusy opening. So there's lots of bergamot, lots of lemon, lime, and orange, okay? But it's mixed with this tarragon note, which can sometimes come across as anisic and almost like this sweet and sour combination in the very opening. And it throws you off because you're hit with a lot of cumin, okay? Almost straight out of the gate. The cumin intensifies later on, but you're also hit with one of the most gorgeous, classical chypre constructions I've ever smelled, okay? The flowers in here are absolutely stunning. The peach note is perfectly spot on. But today, you know, something came out in the base that I never noticed before, or I've noticed it, but it's never been as amplified as it was today. And about 5 to 6 hours in, this leather note showed itself. And it was one of the most beautiful leathers I've ever smelled. And, you know, I've worn this, like I said, 7 or 8 times now since I've had it. And I can't remember. I do log all my wears, but I think it was something like seven wears since I've had this bottle. Seven or eight. And the leather in the base just amplified today. It was just like, wow, where did you come from? And that's the thing about this fragrance. Every time I wear it, it's something different, you know? And so, I mean, I wish I had more than just that, but this is a very expensive fragrance, so I was very lucky to find this partial at a very, very good price. So, Rojas Diaghilev, if you're a fan of Mitsuko, if you're a fan of Rochas Femme, if you're a fan of, you know, Robert Piguet's Bandit, if you're a fan of Estee Lauder's Azure, which is probably one of my favorite leather chiffres of all time, check out Diaghilev. Okay, so let's get started. Top 25, I hope I counted right. Let's see, did I count right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25. Yep, 25 and an honorable mention. So let's do the honorable mention first. Let's do the honorable mention first, and then we'll kind of hop into this. So, the honorable mention is going to be, let's see here, where did it go? Here you are. Okay, sorry, I was looking for my list. Okay, here we go. So the honorable mention is this. This is called Creed's Royal Scottish Lavender. And Royal Scottish Lavender comes in at number 26, or the honorable mention, the bottom of the barrel, because this is one of the worst fragrances I've ever smelled. I should say one other thing about Creed before we move on. That's that I haven't smelled everything. I have a lot, but I don't have everything. They have fragrances that they have done from the past. Like, for example, they have a Cuir de Russie. I would love to smell Creed's Cuir de Russie one day. They also have a fragrance called Tabarome Privé, or Tabarome, Vintage Tabarome, which came out 1 year from like 2009, 2010. You could only buy it in Flacon, and they discontinued it. They claimed it was a re-release from 1875, which is just like, come on, man. No one in 1875 was walking around smelling like that. But they do this from time to time, and they did this same thing with Royal Scottish Lavender. And they claimed this was from 1856, which I'm sure we're all just like, oh, you know, it's like, come on. But I was expecting this to be a good lavender fragrance. Instead, it's complete shite to me. It smells like cheap laundry detergent and neroli. So there's basically lavender, neroli, with vanilla in the base and sandalwood and a little bit of amber and a little bit of clove. And it smells like a terrible knockoff version of this. Caron's Poronome. I would actually much rather wear this, which I will, over this. This is, I'm gonna have to force myself to finish this decant. This is so much better. And I much prefer this version over the newer version. So, Royal Scottish Lavender, the worst Creed. Maybe not the worst Creed, because I did have a couple Creeds. Like, for example, I had a sample of Viking Cologne that sucked so bad I threw it out. And I had a sample of Aventus Cologne, which sucked so bad I threw it out. And so those aren't on the list. I wish I would have kept them. I didn't have a channel back then when I initially sniffed those. But yes, it is. They've put out some good stuff, but they also have put out some terrible stuff. And for the price, I mean, you know, I probably am done buying Creeds. I mean, I don't think there's a single Creed that I want in my collection other than the couple I mentioned that I don't already have. So let's get into the top 25. So number 25 is going to be this. It's going to be Neroli Sauvage. And this came out in 1994, and it's not so much that this is a bad fragrance, but this suffers from a similar, you know, fault as Royal Scottish Lavender. Royal Scottish Lavender really does remind me of Caron's Poronome. This came out in 1994. In 1993, this came out. Eau de Rochas Poronome, which I think is one of the best citrusy, fresh, floral summer scents ever created. It's so underrated. If you can find this bottle with the older style cap, I would say get it if you can. But the new stuff with the silver cap is still good, okay? But these are so close. This came out in 1993. This came out in 1994, 1 year later. Almost a blatant ripoff. And the thing about it is that I smelled this first, and I bought this first, and I thought it was original and unique. I hadn't smelled anything like this. And as soon as I smelled this, I knew that it was Creed that ripped them off, not the other way around. This did not come first. And, you know, it is a good neroli scent, though. I will say that. If you don't care and you're willing to pay a little extra or a lot extra, because this is like a $20 or $30 fragrance, again, just goes to show, top dollar does not always mean you're getting, you know, the best fragrance for that top dollar. And, you know, this is a good fragrance. It claims to have a base of real ambergris, which probably not, you know, but anything's possible. It's probably that Creed ambroxan, salty ambroxan that they do. And they do it very well, to be fair. And you can see I killed the entire bottle. I wore this whole thing. This used to be a real staple in my summer wardrobe. And I can still smell it from the atomizer. And it is nice, but for $500 or whatever they're selling this for, no way. Absolutely no way would I ever give Creed that kind of money for this again. I think I got this discounted anyways, but Neroli Sauvage number 25. Number 24 is going to be a decant, and it's a fragrance that Creed claims is from the year 1950, which we think now is a lie. We don't know, but that's the guess, is that there were no Creeds before about the year late 1960s, I think. And this is called Orange Spice. Okay, so Orange Spice is a creation that really throws people off as far as the perfumer goes, because this smells very similar in the opening to one of my favorite fragrances of all time. This smells very close to Koros. And if you've read the Ghost Perfumer book, you know that Pierre Bourdon is the Ghost Perfumer. That Olivier Creed basically used his lack of confidence and self-esteem to almost steal his creations, in a sense, and put them in Creed bottles. He convinced him that since he was losing briefs and the other people didn't see the genius of his work, to let him, you know, have the formula that were castaways, that Dior or, you know, some of these bigger brands passed on, and to let him have the formula so that they could see the light of day, because otherwise they were just going to sit in a drawer and get thrown out, right? And so that was part of the genius of Olivier Creed. He was able to manipulate, basically, Pierre Bourdon into, you know, giving away his formulas for nothing. The promise of, you know, a couple tailored suits. Could you imagine a Creed suit? I wonder what the quality on that thing is like. And a promise of a huge payout upon Pierre Bourdon's retirement date, which of course never came. Olivier Creed screwed him out of it, basically. And then Olivier Creed went on to sell his business to BlackRock for $1 billion almost, which is mind-blowing to me that Olivier Creed turned this into a $1 billion business. It really seems like there's nothing fair in the world, you know, when you realize that Olivier Creed is a billionaire. But it is what it is. I don't think I would ever buy another Creed, especially what I think they're going way downhill. I think the quality, you know, Olivier Creed was not a perfumer. So what he did is he took many of these formulas these perfumers would make for houses that actually cared about cost. And he just said, screw it, put the highest quality musk, the highest quality ambergris, the highest quality bergamot, all of this stuff and all of these creations, and jack the price up astronomically and claim it's the, you know, princess of Spain's great grandmother from the 1800s that, you know, commissioned this scent. And so anyways, you have that whole crazy backstory. And so Orange Spice throws people off because they smell it and they go, oh, wow, this is Koros. This is like, you know, a Creed's version of Koros. Pierre Bourdon must have done this. Well, apparently, rumor mill is he did not. Someone else did this, which my guess is it was probably done in the 80s to emulate Coros. Okay? And so think about that. Another perfumer tried to emulate Pierre Bourdon's work, and then Pierre Bourdon would end up coming to Creed later and making the Creeds that really sold. How's that for nuts? How is that for absolute nuts? But Orange Spice is a good perfume, and I do like it. And it's simple. It's bergamot, mandarin orange, clove, orange, ambergris, musk, and tonka. And it is mostly animalic, only in the first 15 to 20 minutes, and then it really quickly changes into this very traditional, classic, professional Creed, buttoned up. Creed has that vibe of you can wear it anywhere. The animalic bits only come out in the first 15 to 20 minutes with Orange Spice. Okay, next. That was number 24. Now we're on number 23. And number 23 is a fragrance that, again, I do not think is worth the money. And you can see I use the entire bottle basically. You know what this is? This is Virgin Island Water. Okay, so Virgin Island Water. What is it? Well, it's basically a very simple formula. It is coconuts with lime, Caribbean lime, hibiscus, ginger, a little bit of ylang and jasmine, and this sugar cane, Caribbean sugar cane, and white rum is what they claim. Caribbean white rum and Tonkin musk. So you're basically paying $500 to smell like suntan lotion. And while granted it may be nice and refreshing in the summer, I think there's a fragrance called Saint Bart's that you can get for 20 or 30 bucks that smells very, very, very similar. And so the joke in the Luca Turin book I read, the joke was that Olivier Creed gets in his boat and goes and searches for the highest quality coconuts the world has ever known. Just ridiculous stuff like that. But I do have enough juice to where I can at least do a final review, a goodbye bottle. How many times do you finish a bottle? It's very rare. So I will do a video on this before it's all gone. Okay, next. Next on the list, number 22. Number 22, we have a flanker to Aventus. Excuse me one moment. Turn off the baby monitor. Okay, number 22 is Aventus for her. And the reason this is here is that, well, I can't really wear this. I do think it's a good fragrance, though. They took Aventus and they added more fruits and florals. And the fruits in here are beautiful, I will say that. There's an ylang-ylang note, which they added, which I don't think is in Aventus. And they did add a little bit of this violet leaf, but a very small amount of violet leaf. Really small, enough to where the opening seems a little different than regular Aventus, but it still has that green apple with Calabrian bergamot and pink pepper, and then it has rose, styrax, and they claim Mysore sandalwood, which for 2016, this came out in 2016, this is a 2018 bottle, and it's a 75 mil. Interestingly enough, I thought they pretty much ended their 75 mils and 17/18. So this must be one of the last 75 mil bottles. But it was my wife's signature scent for a long time, and you can see she pretty much finished most of the bottle. She only has about, oh, I don't know, maybe 20 mils left. And it is good. It's I like it on her, but since it was her signature scent for so long, I couldn't wear this. I mean, I could, but it would just seem wrong in a way. So that's why we've got it at number 22. Okay, number 21. Number 21 is a decant. It's not a full bottle. And I think it's the final decant in this countdown. But this is a very hard to find Creed. And it's basically called Sélection Verte. And it came out in 1970. And it's a Neroli. Excuse me. It's a neroli heavy fragrance. But more so the style of neroli that you will find in this. Jacques Fat Green Water, one of the most iconic neroli scents. This is actually the fragrance that has the biggest percentage of neroli ever in a perfume. And this really smells like green water. Again, Creed basically copying a fragrance that was known as an all-time classic in the industry. If you are a fragrance buff, as soon as you smell Selection Bar, you're going to notice it's a take on green water. If you've never smelled green water, though, and you smelled this, again, if you're just a Creed head and you go there and buy their fragrances because you think it's like the, you know, the highest quality stuff and all that, you'll think this smells very unique and fresh, and it is, and it's that Creed freshness, neroli, with citrusy pepperiness in the top, and there is this peppermint, minty vibe to it, too, and it's pretty strong. So if you don't like mint, this might be one to stay away from. But I'm glad I have a decant because I can at least talk about it. It does have this herbal take to it. Maybe there's some thyme or something like that. But in the base, again, only lists ambergris as a base, which to have only ambergris as a base, you would have to have a ton of ambergris in this, which I mean, maybe, but it's probably some mixture of that Creed, sandalwood, and musks. But they only list ambergris. But yes, it's definitely a summer fragrance, and I will talk about it on the channel very soon. Okay, next is a fragrance that they claim came out in 1975. So we're on to number 20. And number 20 is going to be Zesty Mandarin Pamplemousse. Zesty Mandarin Pamplemousse. And these old gray cap. Which are discontinued. These were EDTs. And you know what? This is an interesting fragrance. It's very citrusy and very fresh, okay? And the note listing, again, is very simple. It's listed as bergamot in the top with grapefruit and mandarin orange, white blossoms in the mid, and ambergris in the base. And I will say this for this fragrance. The white blossoms in the heart really smell like honeysuckle. So it smells like white flowers and honeysuckle, which is a note that apparently is very hard to do in perfume. I think there was a fragrance by Zoologist called Hummingbird, if I'm not mistaken, that had a beautiful honeysuckle note. This is really one of the only honeysuckle fragrances that I can think of. I think there might be a small honeysuckle note in Fahrenheit, but it's so overwhelmed by, it's so overwhelmed by all the other stuff in there, the violet leaf, the leather, all that stuff, that you're gonna have a hard time smelling it. Here, you can really smell the beautiful, fresh honeysuckle flowers, and it is beautiful, but it's not my style. It's not my favorite thing to wear. And, you know, when I wear it, I do over-apply, but that's what these kind of fragrances are for. You know, it's definitely that classic Creed DNA from 1975. Okay, next we've got a fragrance that I actually just wore as my scent of the day at number 19. And again, it has a similar problem as a couple of these fragrances we've talked about, in that it is basically a copy of a previous fragrance in a sense. And then to make matters worse, they called it original. So this is original Santal. And I wore this as my scent of the day just this week. This was one of the scent of the days that I wore this week. I wore this to work. I like wearing Creeds to work because they never offend. You could overspray, you know, no one gets offended by Creed normally. And it's a 2015 release, and I'm pretty sure Pierre Bourdon did this one because he did Yop Homme from 1989, and he did Mont Blanc Explorer, I think it's called. Mont Blanc Individual, which smells very similar to this, and he also did the Mont Blanc. And so this has this orange tree absolute with ginger and lavender, pink pepper. There is a little bit of a peppermint vibe, but not too heavy. Not like the Selection Vert. And they claim, again, Mysore Sandalwood in the base, which, you know, this is a 2016 bottle. And if there's Mysore Sandalwood in this, I would be absolutely flabbergasted. And cedar, vanilla, benzoin, ambergris, and musk. Again, very similar to Yope, which I actually prefer wearing Yope over this, believe it or not. Because Yope, the Lancaster version of Yope is much deeper and richer. And I really feel like that's what the fragrance should have been. This has this Creed freshness about it, which this is really, you know, Yope is kind of like this really heavy, dense fragrance. And this takes that DNA and tries to freshen it up a little bit. And so this is 75 mil. You can see the dent I put in these. I wear these. These are not just display pieces for me. I wear my fragrances. And so when I am done with this bottle, would I buy it again? No, absolutely not. But at number 19, we've got Original Santal. Okay. Number 18, let me put Original Santal away. You go back to your home. Number 18, we have a classic. And it's also a Pierre Bourdon. And it's called Silver Mountain Water. Now, my bottle is from, I think, the early 2000s. Okay? And I think that the top notes have turned. I'm 99.9% sure the top notes have turned. It has that paint thinner, yeah, like smell in the opening. If you can stand 15, 20 minutes of that disgusting smell, it does get better. This is my second bottle of this. I did go through an entire bottle years and years ago, probably 8 or 9 years ago. I went through an entire bottle of Silver Mountain Water, and I enjoyed it. And it was very early in my collecting career, and it was when I basically just bought all the Creeds, because I thought, hey, Creed was, you know, the best thing out there, and everything else sucked, and I just bought all the Creeds. And that was very early on one of my biggest mistakes. Do not make the same mistake I made. Price does not equal quality all the time. And so this is this bergamot, mandarin orange, neroli with, there's a beautiful green tea, and the green tea mixes with that sandalwood and musk in a slight marine-like quality, almost like you're smelling, you know, the ice running off of the mountain. That was the selling point here, is that, you know, Olivier Creed climbed Himalaya to get the rarest ingredients and blah, blah, blah. And, it is nice. I will tell you that if this bottle was not turned, I would wear this, especially in summer. This is a beautiful summer scent, but, you know, I'll just use it as a prop for now, and maybe I'll spray it on a card every now and then just to see what the dry down does again. But, that's just going to be one of those fragrances from my past, unfortunately. Silver Mountain Water, but I had to be fair and put it here at number 18. Okay. Number 17. Number 17, we have a tobacco fragrance. Very rare for Creed tobacco. And this came out in the year 2000. It is ginger, bergamot, mandarin orange, lemon, jasmine, sandalwood, vetiver, musk, tobacco, and tea. So again, they use that beautiful tea note that was used in, or very similar tea. I think the tea here is a little bit different. I think in Silver Mountain Water, it was a green tea. And in this one, Tabarome Millésime, it was just a black tea in the base with tobacco. And it is a very unique fragrance. I've never smelled anything that smells like this. And if you wanted to wear a tobacco in the summer, okay, so if you wanted to wear a fresh tobacco, because most Creeds have this fresh DNA, like you can wear them anytime, they're not going to be too heavy, they have this freshness about them. Tabarome Millésime is one of these Creeds where if I get the inkling to wear a tobacco and it's 100 degrees here in Texas, this is the kind of tobacco I would wear, you know, instead of one of the other heavier wintertime tobaccos. And It's also unique, you know, and the tobacco changes. It goes from like a green tobacco to a very fine tobacco in the dry down. It evolves, if you will. And I like that about this. I would love to smell Tabarón Privé or Tabarón, vintage Tabarón, whatever you want to call it. But like I said, that's a real unicorn. So, Tabarón Millésime from 2000. And then, at number 16, we have probably one of the Creeds that really established it as a brand, because this was Sean Diddy Combs, Puff Daddy's signature scent for the longest time, and he told people about it. I mean, he was very vocal that this was his signature scent, and it really kind of put Creed on the map in the 90s. We'll talk about a fragrance that put him on the map in the 80s, but this is called Millésime Impérial. Okay, so this is a bottle from the late 90s, I believe, and this is turned. Creeds have a way of turning because there's a lot of citruses in them, okay? So you have to be very careful when you buy old Creeds, and it is legit. It's not a fake. I mean, it's it is a legit bottle. You can kind of see there. Everything looks correct. It's just, even the, for those of you Creed heads who want to see the inside, yes, it's white. The ring is white. So it's just turned. And again, it's very similar to the Silver Mountain Water. The first 20 or 30 minutes is absolutely awful. And then it kind of starts to smell like Millésime Impérial. But I do have a fresher sample of this. And so I will review it on the channel off of the fresher sample. But that was a big hit in the 90s. That irisy, marine, blackcurrant, you know, fruity, musky Creed thing. And it was very pleasant. And this is also my second bottle. I had a 120 mil of the old bottles where the it was clear. This was all clear, and, you know, only the Millésime Impérial little deal in the middle was gold. But, yes, I've worn a ton of that, just like I've worn a ton of Silver Mountain Water. Okay, now here's one that we're going to put at number 15. And at number 15, we have a fragrance that many of you may be shocked it's this low, but honestly, I'm not impressed by this fragrance at all. It could even be lower, but this is where it ended up going. It's called Spice and Wood. And, you know, Spice and Wood, look at the flacon. I mean, the flacon itself is probably the most beautiful thing of this fragrance. This is a 8.4 fluid ounces. This is a 250 mil. And it is woody, it's spicy. It has this apple note in the opening and angelica root, which usually in angelica, I love anything with angelica in it, angelica root. It also has patchouli and clove and a little bit of birch, but it has that Creed poshness about it. And it has oak moss, iris, musk, and cedar. And there's another fragrance that I own that I actually prefer over Spice and Wood. And I think they both came out very close to the same time. Let me see if I can find it real quick. I think it's right here. Yeah, it is. So this is called Chic Shake. Chic Shake number 70 from Bahrain. You can see created in Bahrain. And so they tried to do something similar like Amouage, you know, and have their own house from Bahrain, just like Amouage is from Oman. And they kind of released a couple, and then they stopped. And, you know, it says Desert Prince right here all around the collar. It's a nice presentation. The bottle does feel beautiful in the hand. One of the most ergonomic bottles I think I've ever come across. But the smell to me is very similar. And in fact, I think I prefer this one. And I got this bottle for like $100 from someone who sprayed it a couple times, didn't like it, and wanted to sell it. So I got a great deal. And I already owned this when I bought this, and so I bought it to be able to talk about it and stuff like that. And I'm a little disappointed. This did not impress me at all. This feels like it could be, and this thing, this 250 mil, I think they sell for like $1,000. These Les Royale exclusive line or whatever they call it. And I've smelled a couple of them too. I've smelled the Musk one. I forget what it's called. But they have a or no, not the Musk one. It's called Sublime Vanilla. I've smelled Sublime Vanilla and it's not impressive at all. So I've smelled a couple of them from the line. Not impressed. All right, number 14. Number 14, we're going to another one that I've rent through an entire bottle, a full 120 mil bottle. This is my second bottle, and it's a disappointing bottle, but I remember what it was like in the 120 mil, and it was a stunner. One of the most amazing sandalwood fragrances I've ever smelled. This one's still nice, but it's lost that pizzazz. It's lost that, poshness about it. This is Himalaya. This is the only 100 mil bottle I have. It is a 2017 batch, so it's before, BlackRock came in, but I would not buy this again. Not at this smell. I expect more from Creed because I know what it was like. That's the thing is I remember what it was like in the old 120 mil bottles, and this is a shadow of its former self. Yes, absolutely. This is a shadow of its former self. It is not what it was. And it's got this basically is this very citrusy, pink peppery, nutmeg, cedarwood, and sandalwood. But the sandalwood, that posh, creamy Creed sandalwood that they do so well, is in here. And there's a gunpowder note. And that gunpowder note, the idea was actually formulated while Pierre Bourdon was working with the boss at Dior. Whenever he did a Dior fragrance. I forget what it's called. La Vita. It'll come to me. But he actually did a fragrance from Dior, for Dior, and it was like an all-time crowning achievement for him because his father worked for Dior very early on, and so for him, doing a fragrance for Dior was like, that's it. My life is complete. I did a Dior fragrance. But while he was working with the boss, I think his name was Maurice Roger, or Roger. I don't know how to properly say his name, unfortunately. But I will say that they had this idea to use a gunpowder note, and when new management came along at Dior, they just basically scrapped it, and that's where Olivier Creed again came along, swooped it up, and made it Himalaya in the year 2002, and. There is this very professionalism about it, and in fact, it does smell very similar to, again, another fragrance which came out a decade, 9 years before this. It's called XS by Paco Rabanne, and that was created by Rosanne Dumatou and Gerard Anthony, the great Gerard Anthony. I need to get a bottle of XS, a vintage, but they're not easy to come by. Okay, so that was number 14. Let me make sure we're on track here because I didn't really count these beforehand, so bear with me. Let's see, we've got one, two. Okay, just want to make sure we're still good and I didn't miscount because that would suck since we're doing a countdown. All right, so number 13. Number 13 is a very hard to find discontinued Harrods exclusive fragrance from Creed, and it's called Millesime 1849. And this came out in 2013. This is again my second bottle. I had a 2013 bottle. I used it up. I then bought this one brand new in 2016, I think it was, because it was a 15 batch, 2015 batch. And I think it's discontinued now. I think this fragrance is like $1,000 on eBay, which is nuts. If I sold my fragrances, I would totally sell this because this is basically a floral woody fragrance, but the wood is that Creed sandalwood but with oud. And if you've smelled royal oud, which is very, very close to the top of this list, you'll see when we get there, you'll smell the type of oud that's used. It's that very westernized oud, and only a little bit of it. you know, Creed wants their fragrances to be wearable. So nothing is supposed to be challenging or animalic. Everything's supposed to be smooth and easy. And that's why I use them as work scents. They're great for the office because they smell kind of posh and stuff like that. But as you get into the hobby, you want the challenging scents. You want Antaeus. You want Koros. You know, you want Joint by Rocco Barocco. You want those kind of scents. And Creed does not deliver that at all. But this is a good fragrance. I enjoy it. It does have a little bit of a powdery element to it. There's a big note of Ylang Ylang. It's Ylang Ylang and Jasmine. And those two florals do really come out in play. But the bergamot in the top with the patchouli and the vanilla and that powdery musk, you know, I enjoy this one. This is a unique one, but it will remind you a little bit of a take on Royal Oud because of the way that the base is used. So, yes, Millesime 1849, the Harrods exclusive, number 13. All right, number 12. Number 12 is a 90s Creed, and this is very close to the true DNA of Creed, if you will. This is Royal Water. And again, this is my second bottle. I went through an entire... Actually, I might even have it here. Just so you guys don't think I'm pulling your leg about this. Yes, okay, here's the box. And look, I'll show you. I went through an entire bottle of Royal Water. This is my second bottle right here. And I can tell you there are differences. They are not exactly the same. This one is a, what are you? Man, the writing is like real, it's etched in 13W01. So this is a 2013 bottle, and this... Man, the etching on this is not very deep at all. 15Y01. So this is a 2013 bottle that I completely went through. This is a 2015 bottle. There are differences, I can tell you that. I think I prefer the 2013 bottle that I originally had. This is still good. But it does feel like there are some slight differences, because when you wear an entire bottle of a fragrance, you get to know, you know, how it operates, what it's like, where the changes are. And when you get another one and it's different, you know, maybe someone who didn't have the experience of wearing the full bottle would never pick up on, you know, the differences. But I think there are differences year to year with these Creeds. And... the standard Creed answer is because, oh, we use so many naturals, you know, it's just because one, it's like, they try to make it seem like it's like Dom Perignon with, champagne, you know, depending on the crop of the grapes that year, this bottle might be different from this one. And some people buy into that. I think it's a bunch of BS personally. But this is a good fragrance. Maybe it will open up. What I really like about it is this is one of the greatest juniper berry fragrances I've ever smelled. It has that freshness, that sprightly zing of juniper berries. But there's also peppermint and lots of lemons and clementine and bergamot. There's even a cumin note in here, but it's very reserved. You really have to kind of search for it. With a base of ambergris and what they call Tonkin musk. Real Tonkin musk is extremely expensive, so who knows? But I will tell you that I do like this fragrance. Royal Water comes in at number 12. Number 11, and then we're into the top 10. Let me put this old bottle away, because otherwise who knows where it'll end up. Okay, number 11. Number 11 is Aralfa. And I will tell you why it's Aralfa. And the reason is, this is one of my favorite marine fragrances of all time. And this isn't even a marine fragrance. I mean, it is, but it is this early 90s marine fragrance. And if you've ever smelled, okay, so these older bottles of Aralfa are much more deep. They're much more green. And it almost feels like there's a pine note in here, even though there's no pine listed. It has that melon aldehydic thing going on in the opening that was popular with the aquatics of the 90s. But then there's also these, you know, herbal rosemary and cyclamen and coriander and pepper and ginger and amber, musk, sandalwood, oak moss. There's oak moss in here. So it kind of reminds, it's like one foot in the 80s, one foot in the 90s. It has this New West by Aramis feel, and it has this Ocean Rain by Valentino, by Mario Valentino, that the great Edmond Rudnitska, who was Pierre Bourdon's teacher, did just 2 years earlier than Aralfa in 92. This also has a little bit of cumin in it, and but there's green basil in what feels like this. Maybe it's the basil, not the pine, but it really feels like there's this green bit. Like there's this touch of old school 80s green, you know what I mean? Like bark and tree that you're smelling with the fresher 90s aquatic. And that's why I like this so much. It's so different than Millésime Impériale, which goes way more into the just fresh, happy-go-lucky 90s. This is more my style if I'm going to wear an aquatic. And I think this is worthy of being the 11th spot. However, I did hear that the newer bottles that come in these 50 or 100 mil are extremely reduced. They're much more simple and they're much more a take on an aquatic, if you will. So that's, but that's what I've heard. I've never done a personal comparison myself. Okay, top 10. Number 10 is going to be one of my favorite fresh vetiver fragrances to wear. So if you want fresh vetiver, if you want, you know, summertime vetiver, this is your vetiver. This is Creed's original vetiver. And again, this smells very similar to a Mugler fragrance called Mugler Cologne. This is also a 2016 bottle, just like my original Santal. You may not be able to see that, but it is a 2016 bottle. And this is, they claim to use all of the types of, all of the parts of the vetiver, which normally vetiver is only the root is used. They don't use the grass. Creed claims to use vetiver leaf, is what they call it, the actual grass portion of the vetiver, which is not an essential oil. It doesn't have anything to do with perfumery, so I don't understand that at all. But maybe it's just a selling point for them. But if you can get past the strange claims that Creed makes, this is a very good fragrance. This is one of my favorite summertime vetivers to wear, along with Guerlain's vetiver. Guerlain's vetiver is the greatest vetiver of all time, in my opinion. Hands down, end of story. I will not hear any arguments. La, la, la. Guerlain's vetiver is the vetiver. But if you want something a little different, something to change it up, and you're a vetiver lover, which I'm not a vetiver lover, but I don't hate vetiver like I used to. I used to really despise vetiver, and it took me a while to kind of come around and understand it, and now I do. And vetiver's a perfect office scent. This is a perfect office scent, by the way. So, original vetiver by Creed. Lovely in the heat. It really shines in the heat. It has this peppery vetiver with that, you know, Creed ambergris musk thing that they perfected so well. It's very posh, extremely posh. Okay. We're number 9, and this fragrance got absolutely annihilated in FragCon when it came out. And again, this is my second bottle, okay? The first bottle was 100 mil, and it was a 2017 bottle, and I used it, the entire thing. I loved it. And it came out in 2017. This is a 2017 flacon I've tracked down, and it's called Creed's Viking from 2017. I would love to know who made this. I would love to know who made this, because this is, many people compare it to Old Spice, but this is much more than that to me. I'll have to do a full review, but what I really love about Viking is there's so much for my nose to explore, okay? And what I mean by that is it's not one-dimensional. This fragrance feels very multifaceted, and when you get to the heart of the fragrance, there is a beautiful ambergris note, absolutely stunning. Whether it's real or fake, I don't care. It's like Andy Tower's Tower Odd that he created, that ambergris impersonation that he made. Probably no ambergris in his fragrances, but it smells so stunning that I don't care whether it's real or fake. And this has that about it. It is so overlooked. I think just the fact that it was put in the same style bottle as Aventus, and it was the follow-up to Aventus, and it got so hyped, and then people smelled it and went, eh, next. And no one cared. You know what I mean? And so this deserves to be revisited. But the original Viking, not Viking cologne. There's a beautiful rose in here. There's also a beautiful sandalwood and lavender. And the lavender, sandalwood, and pink pepper is very posh. This is a high-class scent to me. And very few people will smell like this. Very professional. And you can see I loved it so much. I got the 500 mil. Okay. Number eight is a long discontinued fragrance that they talk about a little bit in the book. They talk about how Creed basically stole this young kid's formula and never gave him credit for it. And it was kind of right at the point in his career where he needed the attention and he never got it because, of course, he had to sign a non-disclosure agreement and all this stuff. But this is from 1973, and it's called Acier Aluminum. And look at the dent I put in this bottle. I do love this stuff. This is an amazing amber. It's so good. This is bergamot with fruits and spices, basically, with ambergris and vanilla. And the vanilla is going to remind you of the vanilla used in a fragrance very close to the top of this list, okay? But this is so good. I mean, my wife thinks it smells like potpourri. I don't. I disagree with that vehemently. But she says it smells like potpourri. And so that may be a negative. That may put you off a little bit. But it does have this syrupy, some people say there's a banana note. There's no banana note in here, but there is a fruity note. There's fruits and spices. And so it may combine to give off this metallic banana-like vibe. But the ambergris and the vanilla in the dry down is just heavenly. I love this stuff. I usually wear it in cooler weather, but I mean, look at the dent I put in this bottle. And this is a 2015 batch. For you Creed batch heads. Okay, number seven. Number seven is what I have learned. I'm gonna call this a Spanish leather. I think it's a Spanish leather if we're categorizing this, but I really don't know for sure. But it has English in the name, but I think it's basically a Spanish leather, and it's called Royal English Leather. Now, up until a couple months ago, and I've given this fragrance a lot of flack, but also a lot of love. I've given it a hard time, and I've said how much I love it. If you went to Parfumo and looked up Royal English Leather by Creed, it said released in the year 1760, and I was like, are you freaking kidding me? The people at Parfumo have to know better than this. Now, if you go to Parfumo and plug it in, it says the release year is unknown. They claim 1760 this came out. I promise you, no one in 1760 was walking around smelling like this. I promise you, okay? But this is a leathery, spicy fragrance, and it has a beautiful orange vibe to it. So think orange, ambergris, with leather, and it's very fresh, And again, just like I said, if you want a tobacco fragrance to wear in the summertime, this is if you want a leather fragrance to wear in the summertime. This is a beautiful, easy to wear leather. It's not animalic, it's not challenging, and yet, whenever I think about wanting to wear a Creed lately, this is one of the Creeds that always pops into my head. And I got this from Mudassir. Thank you, Mudassir. I know this is very hard to find, this Royal English leather, and it used to be one of the cheaper, these EDTs Creed put out, used to be the cheaper way to buy a Creed. And beautiful masculine leather amber, basically, with that Creed posh sandalwood. It's really, really good. Okay, number six, almost to the top five. Number six is a fragrance that you guys will know well. It's basically the Creed that put Creed on the map. And it's a Pierre Bourdon creation. And it is green Irish tweed. And for you Batchhead folks, this is a 2014 batch right there. And this is my bottle that I completely finished. This is my my finished bottle. I'm telling you, I wore the shit out of Creed early in my career. Creed career. This was 14MO1 right here. And look, this one had the old school atomizer on it that I completely killed. And this one in the same year, 2014, has the fire hose atomizer on it. So this was 14A01 and this was 14MO1. So they went to the new atomizer between 14A01 and 14MO1, interestingly enough. But 14MO1 is completely gone. And this is another, this is spring in a bottle for me. You know, this is, I know Rich Mitch wears this on the first day of spring every year. It's become a little bit of a Fragcom tradition, thanks to him. And this is, a fantastic fragrance. I mean, it's the 80s in a bottle. 1985, this came out. Lemon, vervain, peppermint, violet, Florentine iris, beautiful Creed sandalwood, cedar wood, and ambergris. And yes, it does smell like cool water, but, you know, this is higher quality ingredients, and it is very, very posh. Extremely posh. The DNA is recognizable. It smells amazing. It's timeless. I mean, it's a timeless fragrance. But there is a part of me that's gotten a little bored of that DNA over the years, and that's why it's at number six instead of higher. Okay, number five. This being at number five is probably going to offend some people because some people love this scent, some people hate it. I was in both camps. I initially hated it, and now I love it. This is Creed's Royal Mayfair. And you may say, my God, Royal Mayfair over Green Irish Tweed? Yes, right now. These are my favorite Creeds to wear. That's how they're ranked. And I have a decant of Windsor, which I will do a comparison video for you guys one day. But Royal Mayfair is a Creed that I think, and look at the dent again, look at the dent. That's a Creed that I think deserves more love in the fragrance community, in the Fragcom, for the people who love to wear fragrances that are, challenging, and for the people who give Creed a hard time because they are too designerish, that they're not niche enough, smell this. This is taking your shoes off and letting your toes sink into the mink carpet in your Bentley. I mean, it's that posh. It is cruising down Mayfair with no shoes, letting your feet feel the mink carpet in the Bentley. Literally, that's what I think of when I wear this scent, because it's so posh. It has this opening of lime with pine and gin, and it seems very strange. And when you first smell it, it will seem even more strange because there's a eucalyptus note in here. And that eucalyptus note is going to remind you of essential oils at first, but let it continue to dry on your skin, because one of the most perfect rose notes, masculine roses I've ever smelled, comes out in this scent in the mid, and it dries down to this orangey cedar, this woody dry down with the eucalyptus. And if you take a look, it's got this almost like suede, right? It's got this suede feel because it's just smooth. This is smooth as the other side of the pillow. And they claim that, the claim was that this scent was originally made for the Duke of Windsor. And who knows if that's complete BS or not, but either way, it's a very posh fragrance. And then we've got number four. Now, number four is one of my favorite lavender fragrances of all time. And I do have a flacon of this, but I had an older bottle. I had a bottle that I think was around like a 2009 bottle. I can't remember because I made the big mistake of throwing it out. But this also has this suede-like feel because this is also smooth as the other side of the pillow. This is Bois du Portugal. And you can see my flacon. I absolutely love this stuff. Bois du Portugal is basically this simple combination of lavender and sandalwood with that lovely Creed ambergris. There is, of course, some citruses in the opening, the usual bergamot, lemon, lime, mandarin orange, and basil, with pimento, nutmeg, clove, coriander, and lavender, and then vetiver, patchouli, cedarwood, ambergris, and sandalwood. But it's the lavender-sandalwood combo, which is a combo that is used very, you know, often in other fragrances. If you like this, there's many other fragrances like you could try. Try New York Intense by Nicolai Parfumeur. Try this too. This is one no one talks about. Beautiful lavender and sandalwood. Malto Smalto. You know, but if you like this DNA, I would urge you to check out Bois du Portugal. If somehow you never have. This is so posh, so traditionally masculine. 1987. Beautiful. I love wearing this. Beautiful. Number three, so to the frag bros, if you're watching this and you're a frag bro and you're thinking Aventus is going to be number one, it's not, but it is in the top three. Here it is, Creed's Aventus. The fragrance that kind of changed the trajectory of Creed forever, and this is a 2016 batch. This is 16 M01, one of my favorite batches of Creed. This is one of the best Creed batches I've ever smelled. You know, to those of you who are surprised by how expensive vintage Creeds are, there was a $50,000 2010 batch of Creed on eBay. 50 grand, right before the pandemic. It was in, they talk about it in this book. You'll regularly now see these older bottles show up for $3,000 or $4,000. I mean, if someone offered me $5,000, I would sell them this. I would sell them this 2016 bottle, even though it's my favorite, because I do have a 2017 bottle. But otherwise, I'm just gonna wear it. You know, I'm just gonna wear this this fragrance that I always associate with the days before it caught fire. You know, I wore this early on. I think I was wearing this as early as like 2012, 2013. And I remember one day thinking, you know what? I'm never going to wear anything else ever. This is going to be my scent until the day I die. And it does have this. What makes this fragrance so special to me is that it is a chypre, okay? It is a sheep. It's a chypre construction, and I love chypres, hence Diaghilev. And but it's a fruity chypre. It's very likable. It has pineapple, and there's so much more to the story. Once you learn about the pineapple fragrances that Pierre Bourdon created, and you know, all these different facets that come into play. I think there's a beautiful rose note in here as well, just like there's a rose note in Viking. No one talks about it. I think there's rose in here, beautiful Bulgarian rose. You know, everything is exactly where it's supposed to be, and that smoky birch in the dry down is a masterstroke. The musk in the base is apparently what made the scent. There was a special kind of musk that, you know, the House of Creed ended up getting their hands on earlier than others, and it really made the scent. They couldn't do it without the musk. But Creed's Aventus is, I mean, who doesn't know Aventus? I don't think Aventus is the king. I think Koros is the king. But I will always respect Aventus. But I'm not a Aventus, you know, head, or I'm not a whatever you want to call it. I'm not in that Aventus is the best fragrance. And if you say anything bad about Aventus, you're an idiot. And, you know, I'm not in that club, if you will. But I respect it, and I will occasionally wear it. Okay, next, number two. Number two, we have this little gem. And again, 500 mils of a 2016 batch of 16L01 of Royal Oud. Oh, baby. And, you know, Royal Oud is here because I have so many memories with Royal Oud. This is another one where I was wearing very early. I went through an entire 120 ml bottle of Royal Oud. Actually, wait a minute. I take that back. I went through an entire flacon, 250 ml flacon of Royal Oud. And then I bought the 500 ml flacon. And I still have that flacon somewhere where it was just a drop of juice left in it. And so Royal Oud and me have a ton of memories. This used to be like one of my scents. I would go back and forth between Royal Oud and Aventus, you know. And it's got this beautiful woody, spicy angelica with galbanum. It does feel a little bit like French Lover by Frederick Malle, which also has Pierre Bourdon's name on it, interestingly enough. And this is a Julien Rasquinet creation, who is a Pierre Bourdon pupil. So, I mean, the connections are insane when you really think about it. But I love this stuff. I mean, it's one of the best creeds. Like I said, number two in my book. And it does have oud in the base, but Western oud. Okay, easy to wear oud. You could wear this anywhere. Okay, number one. This may shock some of you guys, but I have to put it here because of the connection with one of my favorite fragrances of all time, and that's Shalimar. If you like Shalimar like I do, and I've shown this bottle off a lot in recent videos, but I will show it again. So yesterday I did an unboxing, and we unboxed this 80s bottle of Shalimar EDT. Okay? And this is a 70s Shalimar, I think, in that Guerlain Coca-Cola looking can. Thanks to my buddy Rich Mitch from across the pond. I love Shalimar. It's in my top 10, okay? It's probably the greatest Oriental ever created. And this is Shalimar's DNA with Olivier Creed just basically saying, let's just put the highest quality ingredients in here. Let's just take Shalimar and let's just put the highest quality ingredients in here. And it's Venezia. Venezia is number one for me because when you smell this, it really does smell like you're smelling real Mysore sandalwood. Real Mysore sandalwood. It smells like you're smelling real ambergris and lots of it. The notes are so high. Everything you smell is so high class. It's not a scent that is complex. It's not going to blow you away with complexity, but it will blow you away with how beautiful it is. And you want to talk about an under-the-radar creed. My God. Bulgarian rose with a ton of bergamot. I mean, it feels like they're using like 30% bergamot in the top, with ambergris and that posh creed sandalwood and vanilla. And it's just gorgeous. Even though this is marketed towards women, this is absolutely beautiful. And if you're a guy, don't be afraid of Venezia and do not be afraid of Shalimar. I'm telling you, Shalimar is one of the, you talk about a compliment magnet. Let me just go off topic for a second. People say this is a compliment magnet. If I wear Shalimar out and about in the world, I am almost guaranteed to get a comment. Maybe not a compliment, but a comment. Everyone is always so interested in what I'm wearing when it's Shalimar. Everyone. I get comments from men and I get comments from women. They are almost intrigued. Like they want to know, you know, because they're so not used to smelling a guy smelling like Shalimar. And it's beautiful on anyone. Anyone can wear Shalimar. Anyone can wear Venezia. And trust me, it is gorgeous. If you find this for a good price, get it. Now, this bottle is about 20 years old, okay? This is from before Creed put... This is a vintage. This is what the old Creed bottles... this is what the newer previous versions of Creed look like with the Creed all over it. This is what they look like before. They didn't have the Creed all over it. And you can see the shortened ingredient list. And I think this is discontinued, okay? So I'm pretty sure this is discontinued, this Venezia. So, that's my Creed countdown, top 25. I hope you guys appreciated it. Thank you for watching, everybody. We're at an hour and 11 minutes. I'd love to hear your thoughts. I'd love to hear your rankings or which ones are your favorite. You know, appreciate the support that everyone gives. I will do another one of these. I plan on ranking my Chanels. I plan on ranking my Guerlain. So there's more family portraits to be ranked very soon. But thanks for watching, everybody. Cheers, guys. Hope to see you in the comments and see you again tomorrow. Bye now.